decisions taken under delegated powers. There are no executive decisions since the last meeting. So can we move on? Now come to item four, which is the Ferry, the 200,000 Ferry allocation decision. As I say, welcome to the people from the Ferry who are here this morning with us. Pass over to Councillor Williamson. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thanks, Pat. Cast our minds back to March 2017, the explosion in New Ferry, which was devastating for everyone involved there. It's a miracle nobody died. I know first hand about that because I live in the roads where the explosion happened and I was evacuating as well. And I really admire the way the community's come together and stood strong in the face of such adversity. All officers were on site immediately. We worked hand in hand with our colleagues from the police and fire service and everything we could to make the site safe, clean the area up as best we could. So for more than 2 years now, we've always been emergency support from central government. We've had a dialogue with the Minister for the Northern Powerhouse. We've spoken to successive secretaries of state and also the Governor to make the Wirral South. She's raised questions on our behalf in the House of Commons on many occasions. We've had Theresa May visit Merseyside along with James Brokenshire in the last year or so, and none of them have the courtesy to come and see just exactly how the ferry has been devastated, let alone extend any kind of financial support to us. We took it upon ourselves to start buying up land in the area. We've invested £1.3 million so far, so we can rebuild the area again and make sure that New Ferry once again becomes a thriving community and a vibrant high street. We're determined and lacking. This proposal today is about the residents and business owners whose lives were so badly affected by what happened that night. It's a small token, it's not designed as compensation, but it is a recognition of the suffering that you've been through. You know that the property which was lost, and you know you can't remove the memories of the trauma that night, but the two people could provide some support and help you in some way. I'm really pleased to move the recommendation of this report, and I'm sure that I've got the colleagues.
Thanks, Jeanette. Any other comments from cabinet members? Students? We've all first hand stories and experiences suffered by residents in New Ferry. It's been a tragedy. I think it's for all of us when I say go for the residents, get justice soon and the legal case resolved. Jeanette is absolutely right. Those hardship that change on the system. They're a gesture of support and solidarity to a group of people who have gone through a terrible trauma. I'm pleased to be able to make that we've been able to make them and hope that very soon we'll be working alongside the residents as we build the town. Thanks, Chair. Is there any other comments? Councillor Jones.
Thanks, Chair. For me, it's about people. It always has been, always will be about people. We've been buying up land, we've been lobbying government for support, which the children to ignore. We did clean up, we looked after the security, and we've done everything within our power to help the people keep them safe. This is about recognising what people went through. The upset, the trauma, it's stuff that will never leave them. We're trying to help. And I'm delighted that we're able to do this. So I fully endorse and support the recommendation, but I'd also like to add, I'd like to place on record my thanks for everything that the officers did, up to and including this morning, everything that officers have done and are continuing to do to support those in New Ferry. Thanks, Chair.
Thanks, Chair. I think it's only right that we should place on record our thanks to the people of New Ferry. The community there have come together and supported each other in a way which is an example to the whole country. New community organisations were created, new support networks were forged, and everyone came together to back each other up and look out for their neighbours. If that kind of spirit could be bottled I'm so impressed by how they have handled this tragic incident, and they are a present to our board. I fully support the recommendation.
Okay, thank you, Rich. Can you say, I mean, I wholeheartedly agree with the comments from the cabinet members. We do have a shared view, obviously, that we very can't be left behind. And I know we've had meetings with the residents, and we've talked to them in depth and in detail, and listening to the stories, the dramatic stories, as they describe to us. And we can't help but be moved by that. There is a number of things as well which we are doing. I think it's important to reiterate that, because at the end of the day, we want to see this area regenerated, and we've said it's a priority for us in terms of regeneration on this council. And that's important, man, because there's a lot of areas in the borough. But you know, as far as we're concerned, because of what has happened there and what the residents have gone through, we see this as a priority in terms of regeneration. But of course, it won't happen on its own. It only happens resources and money being put there, and trials we've done, and trials the residents have done, when we met with the government minister, with Alison McGovern, that wasn't to be through government, but we have ourselves, through our officers, as Councillor Jones has indicated, tenaciously put together bits for funding, big funding, to help kickstart that regeneration. That's so important. And as we know, and as I said on last Monday at full council, we've been successfully shortlisted for the Future High Street Fund, which is the only area in the Liverpool City region to be allocated that, and the only area in the country to actually have two bids, which is a credit to our officers for putting those bids together. We will receive £150,000 as well to help us put that business case together to actually bring that money in, and potentially with that particular bit there's up to £25,000. So there's a lot of money. So £25 million, I do apologize. Yeah, slightly more. So it's £25 million. So it's a lot of money, and it can make a big difference. And at the same time, we're also putting together a business case, and it's been submitted to the Liverpool City Region for SIF, which is a strategic investment fund, which again is big money, which can match that money as well. On top of those monies, helps to date. I think our officers are doing the best. But I met with, as I said, with residents on Friday gone as well, with Alison Governor, and I listened to what they had to say on a number of issues. Promise as well that we'll come back and try and answer some of those issues, not all of them, some of them, on the basis that we are doing our best, and we are helping and working together to understand where residents are coming from. So, as I say, today's about agreeing to allocate our hardship funding to the people and business owners who have suffered the terrible hardship. And can I ask Cabinet to agree to the recommendations as they are laid out? First of all, can I propose a recommendation and a second? Can we agree?
Agree.
Thank you very much, Cameron. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Right. We'll move on to the agenda. The rest of the agenda. Moving on to item number 5.
decent home is also key to our educational attainments, health and well-being. Indeed, the link between housing and health was recognised by Clem Attlee when he became Prime Minister in 1945, as my bedroom, flat for the NHS, was appointed as Minister for Health and Housing. Building on our tradition, one of the legends of the Rural 2020 plan is the provision of quality housing which meets the needs of residents. However, proportionally, the poorest housing divisions are consistently found to be in the private sector. Therefore, improving the private sector properties and tackling the empty properties is the fundamental piece of the Council work to support our pledge. Wirral's private rental sector has almost doubled in size in recent years, providing a much needed source of accommodation. The majority of houses in the sector across the board are in good condition and are well managed. However, the minority are substantially below required standards and are poorly managed. In order to maintain a healthy private rental sector and travel property management standards, intervention by the Council is often necessary. This intervention ranges from the provision of advice through to prosecution, using the range of legal powers available. In order to clamp down on what is by refers to growing landlords, new powers have been introduced to assist councils in tackling the problem. These powers include alternatives to prosecutions and use of orders to name a few. Ensuring that Wirral also has healthy housing markets, a range of powers are also available to that tackle to shoot there and to pick those boxes back into housing use. All such power involves a full sale, where the council forces a sale of problematic empty properties in order to recover previous expenditure incurred by the council due to non-compliance or legal notices. This power will be used to force a sale of a problematic empty house as a last resource. This report therefore proposes cabinet amendments to both existing and the introduction of new policies and procedures to enable the council to effectively use all powers available. This will strengthen the council's position in using these powers, as well as provide clear information on when and how these powers will be used. The proposals for which you call may have this issue clear and set as clear warrants for landlords, as if they do not meet their responsibilities, then there will be consequences, and we will not hesitate to act. This is about protecting vulnerable residents and members of low-income households and families, and I'm pleased to move the recommendations. Thank you, Stuart. Any other comments from cabinet members? Mr. Miss Gray.
Thank you. I think you see this all the time, say to my board. It's about low-income families choosing between heating and eating. They're forced to live in substandard accommodation. I find this absolutely right.
Thank you. Any other comments? No? Okay. Can we agree the recommendations set out in the report? The proposer? Second. Agree?
Do we agree?
Thank you. Okay. Move on now to item number 6, approval of business case and consultation proposed for proposed selected devices. Again, the cabinet member for housing, Councillor Stuart Whitting.
The selective licensing scheme is innovative and really popular for residents. To give some context to colleagues, this scheme requires every landlord in a particular area to get a license to commit them to give their homes to a specific standard and keep them there. If they don't meet the standards, then they're going to take up the rental market. Even though privately rented accommodation can be found across the borough, there are distinct areas with higher numbers of empty, lower value, poor condition, privately rented properties towards the east of the borough, and it makes sense to focus resources in these particular areas. Selective licensing is a discretionary power to target resources at these areas through an intelligence-led approach. In selective licensing areas, all landlords must have a license to operate. Further to our license or comply with license conditions, it's an offence. Wirral introduced 4 selective licensing areas in 2015 and has recently added a third 4 areas. Action taken to date has established that there are landlords and agents who act responsibly in these areas. However, compliance with required minimum standards has been extremely low, with 70% of properties not compliant with the required standards on first inspection. The first 4 selective licensing areas are due to cease in 2020 and reached the end of their 5-year life. Whilst there has been an improvement in these areas, there's still much to do. The new evidence base undertaken earlier this year has highlighted the need to continue the scheme and enforce that the western areas have commenced in 2015, and also that 3 new areas also meet the conditions to benefit from the start. third areas, all of these were. And I'd like to recommend that Cabinet support these recommendations.
Okay. Thanks, Chair. Any other comments from Cabinet members? Also, any leads?
Thanks, Chair. These kinds of issues we're talking about today, which make the local parks so vital. It's actually about housing and infrastructure and shaping a place so we meet the needs of residents now and in the future. Once our local plan to help address some of these issues, making sure people can get easy access to the right kind of housing for their families, and have, I'm happy to support the recommendations.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Thanks, Pat. Yeah, I wholly support this. It sends out a strong message to there's just now a number of landlords on Wirral who rent out what are effectively modern day slums, and that's not good enough for our residents, so I'm really pleased with this.
Thank you. Councillor Thompson.
Yeah, just echoing what Councillor Williamson said earlier, to make some landlords responsible. There are small number who let substandard accommodation, most people can't, or many people can't afford to survive, and we were working on delivering some really good quality social housing, but this is a piece of the puzzle, and I'm looking forward to seeing what people have to say about it in consultation, and fully support this.
Thank you, Councillor Ms. Gray.
Understanders in their position represent significant overspends and ongoing future pressures for children and families by directors, with the rising number and cost of looked after children. The average current cost of the placement for a looked after child is over £3,000 a week, and the cost has been rising by over 70% in the last financial year. Directors have been able to mitigate the overspend on these costs as a result of holding post-vacant whilst undergoing the restructure. This restructure is now complete. As a result, will result in significant pressures going into 2019-20 financial year. In adult care and health, an overspend of £5 million is as a result of increasing the amount. And that's being mitigated by the learning difficulty transformation programme that's driven out £2 million worth of savings during this year, and where it's ongoing for council and NHS partners in order to manage demand for social care by maximising service users, independence and well-being. Once again, these are continuing pressures that will recur in 2019-20. With the delivery services and overspends being reported in 2018-19 as a result of an underachievement of income on green waste, the cancellation of the car parking charges, linking targets in coastal locations, and the decision to keep Wood Church Leisure Centre open rather than operating on reduced open hours. The last two items have been mitigated by growth items in 2019-20 budgets and for garden waste and remarketing campaigns in place in 2019-20 and an easy way forward movement. To enable the council to report an underspend last year, despite the significant pressures highlighted, there were savings made on council finance budgets by profiling non-energy capital schemes in different years and effective management of cash balances, meaning less interest costs from borrowing. So I think this will be able to continue into 2019-20, and therefore we must ensure that every pound we spend in the next financial year provides value for taxpayers' money
and is only spent on our key priority. In terms of the capital programme, just mentioning there's been a significant plan reprofile of capital schemes. The main schemes include electronic support planning for domicile repair providers, further rollout of agile working for staff, major highways roads including junction improvements on the S63 cycle, footway improvements, and speed building measures for solid repairs. The capital programme was fully funded last year with £19 million from the borrowing, £15 million from grants, £15 million from capital receipts. During the year, just over £3 million of debt was written off, relating mainly to council tax, but also including business rates, housing benefits, and sundry debts. These debts are only written off whether they're practical or economical. It's not practical or economical to pursue them any further, such as bankruptcy or the debt is deceased. Council's process for collecting debt is robust but ethical with regard to council tax, and an additional £9.4 million was collected as compared to 2017-18.
Serves to inform, to be treated with a haphazard, slapdash, or scatterbrain approach. And whilst we continue to operate in a prudent manner, it's pretty much like trying to close a stable door after the horse has bolted. Thanks very much.
Between sort of adult and children's social care, which should be the 18-19 pages, 229 to 244, yes. And people, all the other pages, which are all listed.
Please now receive for considerably short amount of time now. So the Treasury Management Annual Report, this report provides an annual report of Treasury Management activity during 18-19. Treasury Management strategy is agreed by Council each year, and the Council fully complies with its legal obligation under the Local Government Act 2003 to have regard to both the CIFA Code and the MHCLG guidance on investments when conducting its Treasury Management functions. As reported in the Revenue Outturn Report, the Council will underspend on its Treasury activities during the year as a result of proactive management of cash balances. During the year, the Council will be paid £111 million in debt and accounted just under £100 million in borrowing. During the year, there was a change in the minimum revenue provision, which is the amount the Council set aside for the repayment of future debts, and this is still subject to external audit. If agreed, this will result in further savings for the Council in 2019-20. This will be reported as part of the final accounts to the Audit and Risk Management Committee once the accounts have been signed off by the Council's auditors in 2040.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Williamson. And any comments? Councillor Jane McManus.
Thank you, I think, Jeanette, this is really fantastic news. I think the congratulations should go to our finance team, including myself and some of the team at the back there, who helped to deliver this. A £2 million investment in just a year is really a fabulous result. And that kind of money helps us keep the basic services running, so it helps keep our streets clean, it keeps our parks looking good, keeps the lights on, keeps libraries open. And we couldn't provide these basic services without initiatives such as this. So congratulations on that. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Pat. It's an example of how we need to work in the future. Wirral Growth Company, Wirral Waters, all the work we're doing with the Cool City Region, Borough of Culture, all these particular work streams were designed to trigger investment and bring some money into the borough. Money which gets directly invested into the services that our residents need and value. Perfect example of it being done, not just being done, but being done well. And it's having a massive impact. And I just want to place on record my thanks to anyone involved in it. Thanks, Chair.
Thanks, Councillor Jones. Any other comments? Okay. Just basically, just to reiterate what everyone said, it's not often we get to celebrate a financial report. We say taking more than £2 million from clever investments and good management is a brilliant result. As colleagues have said, the money we wouldn't otherwise have had, and it pays for services and it stops us obviously, of course, in other areas. We need more of this, and because we've got huge challenges ahead. So we need to maximise every commercial opportunity. And I know we are doing that in a number of ways, and we have to try and see protect our services. I want to add my thanks to the people who delivered this for us, and finally ask the cabinet